on role of O-leaf, A-leaf and X-leaf by Dr. Manas.
This is changing. Good afternoon, chairpersons. I like to thank all faculty who kept on listening to my instructions of add cases, explain, talk for 20 minutes, but I didn't follow those instructions. So pardon me because I don't have a case to tell you to explain, but doing O-leaf like anterior fusions, we have started recently, maybe 2 years ago, two and a half years ago, so we don't have many cases or many experience. It had been difficult to find faculty for me. Whomever asked, they said, no, I don't want to speak. I don't want to give homework. So I have to thank Dr. Deepak, Dr. Parthivan, Dr. Pragnesh, who agreed to be faculty. I mean, they had experience, plus they had, I know that they had to do a lot of homework also to make you people understand. I also had to agree that today I have learned a lot of things, and I'm sure you also would have done. I'll be speaking on three types of anterior fusion, minimally invasive, like anterior lumbar fusion and X-leaf and O-leaf. But tell our experience on O-leaf. This is a classical case of patients with degenerative spine who come to us, usually 50 years man, with dull aching back pain, has tried all types of medical management, must have seen at least half a dozen neurosurgeons, and must be dissatisfied with that. And after doing clinically, they'll have no deficit except for paraspinal muscle spasm. SLR will be negative, and no motor deficit, and reflexes are normal. In the scan, even do an X-ray, you just see a reduced disc height, and there may or may not be degenerative spondylolisthesis depending on the age, and end plate sclerosis. So do we offer any surgery to them or not? There may be facetal hypertrophy and foraminal stenosis also, without central canal stenosis. Now, depending on the duration of the disease, the MRI can have changes. You can have stage 1, stage 2, and stage 3 MRI changes, depending on the duration of the disease. Now, most of the time, it is like a black disc and back pain. This like this, all are white. It's only a one black disc, not significant compression central canal stenosis, but bilateral foraminal stenosis or persistent back pain. Now, these are the cases which have good indications for anterior lumbar fusion after all types of measures have failed, like doing all types of conservative treatment has failed. Now, earlier people used to do posterior lumbar interbody fusion, but nowadays anterior lumbar interbody fusion has come because it is easier. I'll explain you which is better. Is this a posterior fusion or an anterior fusion? Now, in anterior fusion, one can do more complete discectomy than a posterior fusion. The amount of disc removal is more. One can place a larger graft, and you can restore the disc height because the larger graft can be placed better than the posterior. And it causes indirect decompression because when you increase the disc height, the foraminal stenosis also gets corrected. And then you can maintain lordosis because you have grafts which gives 6 degrees angulation, 10 degrees angulation, and then the lordosis correction is better than the posterior graft. And the area of fusion also is more because the anterior grafts are 3 times bigger than the posterior graft, like T-leaf and P-leaf and PLIF grafts. So the area of fusion is better, and because the fusion is better and the larger graft, the chances of subsidence also is less. The common indications are degenerative spondylolisthesis, like grade 1 or 2, not 3 and 4, or degenerative disc disease, or a recurrent disc herniation, or a failed disc, because a failed disc with scoliosis doing a posterior surgery probably is a little has a higher risk of root damage as the anatomy is lost because of epidural fibrosis. Doing anterior becomes easier as it is a virgin area, or in cases of pseudoarthrosis or spinal deformity, as we have been explaining from morning. Now, what is the rationale for ALIF? Biomechanically, in a normal lumbar spine, 80% of the load is taken by the anterior column and 20% by the posterior. But as we age, the spinal load changes. 60% is by anterior and 40% of the load bearing is by the posterior elements. So when you do an ALIF, you actually augment the anterior, so you're going more physiological. So, and because the compression pressure is more anteriorly, thus the fusion rates also will be better when you do an anterior fusion. And you can probably go back to 80-20 instead of 60-40. And 90% of the vascular osseous surface is in the anterior area, and there is more cancellous bone graft, so better fusion rates than posterior approach. And it spares the paraspinal muscles, spares the spinal nerves, spares the posterior bony elements. So we had listened for the open approach from Dr. Surya Prakash and Dr. Sajesh Menon, and I am just an interface between Sudhir, where he'll be talking more of minimal invasive approach, using both anterior and posterior minimal invasive approaches. But there has been a lot of debate whether posterior is better or anterior is better. Now let me explain about one study where they compared the anterior and the posterior. Now the posterior, though it is superior in the fusion rate, but the blood loss is more compared to the anterior, and the operative time, though earlier when you used to do ALIF was more, but with the minimal invasive it has come down. But the clinical difference is not significantly a difference between anterior or posterior. With minimal invasive approach, the patient comfort is probably better with anterior than posterior. And the fusion rate also quite good, probably better than posterior when one does an anterior fusion. So what are the different ways of doing an interlumbar fusion? These are the LIFs one has to understand. One is called anterior lumbar interbody fusion, ALIF. PLIF is posterior lumbar interbody fusion. TLIF is transforaminal interbody fusion, and TLIF and PLIF we regularly do. XLIF is extreme lateral interbody fusion. OLIF is oblique lumbar interbody fusion. And OLLIF is oblique lateral lumbar interbody fusion. I'll explain you what all these LIFs are in our life. Among these, ALIF, OLIF, and XLIF, or other synonym is DLIF, is anterior approach, and PLIF and OLIF and TLIF are posterior approaches. TLIF is minimally invasive, commonly done through the transforaminal route. PLIF, nowadays people have stopped doing posterior lumbar interbody fusion. OLIF is something which is done with an endoscope. When you do a transforaminal endoscopic discectomy or a PLED, you can also place an expandable cage through that. That is called oblique lumbar interbody fusion. Whereas anteriorly, when you do transperitoneally or extraperitoneally in a supine position, it is more done for L5 and S1. It is called anterior lumbar interbody fusion. It can be done for L3, 4, and L4, 5 also. But when one does directly through the psoas muscle laterally in through the extraperitoneal space, it's called XLIF or DLIF. But going through the psoas muscle has its own problems because there is a potential damage of the risk of damaging the lumbar plexus. So to avoid that, one can go in front of the psoas muscle between the vessels and the anterior part of the psoas muscle, there is a bare area. If one goes through that extraperitoneally, it's called oblique lumbar interbody fusion. So that has less risk of damaging the lumbar plexus. So TLIF can be done as an open approach or through a tubular technique, which Dr. Sudhir will be speaking. And what I'll be speaking about the anterior lumbar fusion. Now, anterior lumbar fusion, one can do a transperitoneal or retroperitoneal in a supine position. Normally, it is done for L5 and S1. As I explained, that the size of OLIF case is 3 times to that of TLIF. This is the comparison of the size of the cages between olive and tilip, where one can see here that the surface area is 3 times. And the advantage is one can correct lordosis in X-leaf and A-leaf, but not much in T-leaf. The problems with doing A-leaf is one has to manipulate with the large vessels. If you do L3, 4, L4, 5, one has to dissect the aorta and vessels, and one has to have an access surgeon. We cannot do independently. We need to call the vascular surgeon or the general surgeon. This can be done open or laparoscopically. And in, so the risk of vascular injury is higher and the blood loss is higher. And if and because of the sympathetic plexus damage also, the chances of retrograde ejaculation is higher, especially in males. So this has not become, though it was done earlier, it is not popular nowadays. And anterior lumbar fusion also is difficult. Dr. Surya Prakash also was showing in one of his X-ray, could see that the aorta was calcified here. If you have usually in elderly people, the aorta is calcified, then so it's a contraindication to do anterior approach in a calcified aorta, or when you have earlier vascular reconstructive surgery done, or when you have an anterior abdominal surgery done as the planes are lost, or you have a severe pelvic inflammatory disease, or there is a prior any anterior spinal surgery done, doing a redo surgery anteriorly is difficult. And transverse, again, is contraindication as it's L5S1 is difficult to access through the lateral as the iliac crest comes in the way, as what happens in the transforaminal discectomy. So doing L4-5, one can do through the transverse or oblique, but L5-S1 one cannot do. So one has to probably do anterior or posterior in L5-S1. And ALIF, as I explained, the vascular complication rate has been quite high. Though means it's a 2% serious vascular complication there, it can be life-threatening because of the damage of the vessels. And so in 212 patients were on the paper, they had one arterial injury, 4 venous injury, though there was no mortality. But still, this is not an acceptable complication for just pain, surgery for the pain. The other main complication with anterior approaches is retrograde ejaculation. And in males, it's almost 1 to 7%, which is probably not acceptable. Anterior approach is not as popular as the lateral approaches. In a lateral approach, one not manipulate the iliohypogastric hyperplexus plexus or manipulate the carotid artery. One goes works between the psoas muscle and the aorta. So if it's an X-leaf, one goes directly through the psoas muscle. But one has to know where exactly the lumbar plexus is to avoid damage, or the chances of damaging the lumbar plexus is higher when one does through transverse approach. But then one has to always supplement with doing an posterior approach. So in an ALIF, it becomes a two-stage surgery. First do an anterior and do a posterior. Whereas in a posterior approach, one can do and posteriorly only both anterior fusion and posterior fusion. So extreme lumbar interbody fusion, as I told, it is less invasive. It's good. It gives a good increase in disc height, and useful for deformity surgery, especially when we want a short segment fixation. Maybe if we do this, probably we cannot go to T4 or C2. The chances of PJK also might come down. To do a X-leaf, one has to understand that the anatomy of the lumbar plexus, as the complications of paresthesia and dysesthesia is quite high, is almost 12% when one does an X-leaf. But it can be brought down to 2% if one does an O-leaf. Now, how to avoid this lumbar plexus damage? One can use intra-op monitoring, where you can stimulate and see that you do not stimulate any nerve damage with X-leaf. But then the cost of treatment increases. The other way to do is do a neurography, MR neurography. Tomorrow we have a lecture on MR neurography. In MR neurography, you can identify where exactly is the lumbar plexus in relation to the body. Normally, the safe zone is zone 1, 2 of the body, or the three. Like if you see here, the zone 3, the plexus is almost 42%. and in zone 4 the plexus damage is almost 45%. So if one remains in zone 1 and 2, it is safe, will not damage the lumbar plexus, but zone 4 and 5 are no, 3 and 4, one should not go through that. So in an X-ray, as the safer zones I told, it's always the anterior half of the body is safe, which can avoid lumbosacral plexus damage. Now, but then that is the standard anatomical, but one can also do MR neurography, find out the relation of the plexus with the body, and then plan your entry point or discectomy depending on the plexography, what is MR plexography. So this is again a picture of a plexography showing the femoral nerve in relation to the nerve. So if you remain in the anterior half, probably it is safer. But then probably it is not safe to do at this level. So to avoid these complications of lumbosacral plexus damage, one can go in front of the psoas and behind the aorta. So this is called oblique lumbar fusion. This was done earlier with an open approach, which Mayer described long ago in 1997, where he uses retroperitoneal corridor to do a corpectomy or discectomy, but it had not become popular. The anterior to the psoas also avoids lumbar, not only plexus, but also the iliohypogastric plexus, so retrograde ejaculation is less because the sympathetic plexus damage is less. And the drawback is one cannot do at L5-S1 level. It can perform from L2 to L3, L3-4 and L4-5. One cannot go high up or one cannot go down. So that is a drawback of this OLIF. The indications are similar, failed fusion, scoliosis, spondylolisthesis or degenerative spine with or without radiculopathy. This is a classical case. It's a black disc with bilateral foraminal stenosis. There was no central canal stenosis. Patient is positioned in a lateral position. And then one can break the table so that opens up the space. Normally it is done on the left side as the aorta is there, but depending on the scoliosis curvature, you always do it on the convex side. It is easier to do on that side. Then identify the disc space, the anterior border, the posterior border, mark the disc space, surface marking of that disc, and one has to incise in front of that. One can do on directly on the disc space, but that causes muscles, a lot of muscle dissection, but you can start the incision in front of the disc space, so it's easier to enter the retroperitoneal space. So as I explained, one can do incision here or go in front. Nowadays, this is one of the earlier cases, but doing anteriorly is easier to enter the retroperitoneal space. I usually take help of an general surgeon who comes and do, but we also can learn and do it. The entry, once you enter the retroperitoneal space, the ureter has to be identified and separated. One has to enter the disc either in the center or the anterior half, so because the psoas almost covers the posterior half. And confirm that the enter the disc, do a discectomy. This is the tubular retractor placed after it is you identify the disc space. And then discectomy is done. Using the shavers, check with the AP X-ray that one has to cross the pedicle here and reach, or sometimes one needs to break the opposite osteophyte to correct and place a cage to correct the degenerative scoliosis. Without breaking the spondylo osteophytes on the opposite side, it's difficult to correct. And then use a sizer to decide the proper size. One has to check both AP and lateral to decide the height and the length of the cage one has to place. The sizer has to come across the pedicle on both sides. It has to go from one pedicle to the other pedicle. And then the correct size of the graft is decided, and the graft is filled with either autologous bone graft or artificial bone graft, whatever one prefers. And then this is the cage after the final placement, that it goes from the one side of pedicle to the other side pedicle with correction of the scoliosis. Earlier, this was not FDA approved for standalone OLIF cages. One always had to do a posterior percutaneous fixation. So initial cases, we had to do posterior fixation, but now FDA has approved of placing anterior fixation also. So I'll be showing cases of both cage with anterior fixation as well as posterior fixation. This was the oldest man, elderly, we had operated. This is the first case we had done when we had a Japanese orthopedic surgeon come to us. He was an 84-year-old man with neurogenic claudication, had an earlier laminectomy done when he was at young, at 50 years. And this was the X-ray with osteoporosis with degenerative scoliosis, kyphoscoliosis. The first step we did the stage one OLIF at two level, and stage two we did pedicle screw fixation with augmented vertebroplasty and corrected. This is a limited fixation. It did not go till D12. We just corrected only a short segment because we had done OLIF also. This is the case two. This is a 16-year-old girl who's a tennis player who came with bilateral radicular symptoms with obesity, and she wanted to play tennis after surgery also. And this was the MRI, which showed a central disc. But then because she was obese, so doing a discectomy, she wanted to play tennis. She said she may not, just doing a discectomy probably would not have been enough. So we did an OLIF. So this is a two-level discectomy. Olive, you can see the cage here. Before we took her for posterior fixation, we did an MRI immediately post-op, and you can see here that disc height also had reduced, and the compression, fortunately, the central disc also has come out. There was no compression. So, but then, as this is not approved only for anterior fusion, we went ahead and we did a percutaneous posterior fixation also. This is almost like 5 years old, that girl, 5 years post surgery. Now this is another case, 45-year-old male with neurogenic claudication. And you can see here that there is no central canal stenosis. We did an anterior oblique lumbar interbody fusion and did a fixation laterally, just putting the standard pedicle screw and a rod. This failed back surgeries are good indications for anterior fusion, as most of them come with a scoliosis, degenerative scoliosis. Correcting the deformity, you can see here there is a retrolisthesis here, and because it was failed back, so the first step we did was an anterior interbody fusion. As posteriorly doing TLIF in a failed back has a higher, because dissecting the roots with the epithelial fibrosis may be difficult, so that's why we decided to do an OLIF, and then followed by a percutaneous screw fixation. We did it, the percutaneous fixation was done using navigation and OAM, but experienced surgeons probably don't need it. And I'm sure Dr. Surya Prakash will tell why you're using orthopedic OAM. People who do not know to put screws, they need OAM. But then it gives safer, it gives psychological satisfaction that we are in the right place. And this is 14 cases. Now we have done, we have added another 6 cases recently. But here we had done 2 levels in 5 cases, single level 9 case. Posterior fixation was done in 6 and lateral fixation was done in 4. Vascular postoperatively, 5 of them had good outcome, 3 and 2 were acceptable outcome. But there was good correlation, means correction of the lordosis in and restoration of disc height in all of them. Now this is what we have done recently in the past 2 months, where this was a retrolisthesis with canal stenosis there. So we placed same thing, oblique screw and anterior fixation. Now this is approved that we don't have to do a posterior fixation, just do an oblique lumbar interbody fusion and anterior lateral fixation. And this patient is only 1 month old, and till now he's happy. This is a follow-up case of OLIF, which was operated in 2016, 2 years follow-up in October 2018. And now this is the scare X-ray. The correction has been good, and there I can see here there has been fusion also starting at the level of interbody fusion. What are the complications of OLIF? The risk of the complications are quite less compared to this paper had a 15 years retrospective study of 800 patients. The complication rate overall is 3.7%, quite less compared to anterior lumbar interbody fusion through transperitoneal approach. The vascular complication rate is only 0.37%, and compared to 2% in ALIF, and the radicular symptom complication is 0.37 compared to almost 12% in XLIF. And so if you have to choose between ALIF, OLIF and XLIF, probably OLIF is better, but then it has a limitation that one can do L2, 3, 3, 4 and 4, 5. So advantages of OLIF over direct approaches, because one can prevent retrograde ejaculation, the chances of damaged two vessels are less, but disadvantage is it can be done only for three levels. If I have an algorithm, if you have an L5 S1 level, probably anterior approach is better, but if it's L4-5, depending on the height level of the iliac crest, and in the MRA one has to see the division of the aorta. If the aorta is divided at a higher level, then again only becomes a problem, because there is no space between the vessel and the anterior border of the psoas. So one has to see the axial cuts of the MRA properly, that do we have enough space between the anterior border of the psoas and the vessel to decide. So if you have a higher iliac crest, or the iliac vessels are divided at a higher level, again anterior approach probably is better, or doing a posterior approach is better directly. Or but then if from L2 to L5, OLIF or retroperitoneal approach is better. And if it's above at a higher level, then doing a standard posterior approach is better. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Manas. Thank you. Questions from audience? You have to ask some question to the audience. Probably, I think the boys are a little bit stunned by listening OLIF.
Sir, yes, when you're doing OLIF,
come forward. Yeah, come.
So they don't want me to ask question.
Yes, sir. That nice presentation. Huh? Nice presentation, sir. When you're doing OLIF, is it sufficient to fuse only anterior per segment, or we have to fuse the posterior segment also?
As I told you earlier, when OLIF, always you have to add anterior fusion also. Just the cage is enough, not enough. So if you do an anterior fusion, and if it's a grade 1 or grade 2 listhesis, then anterior is enough. But then if you have a long segment scoliosis, then you have to do the correction posteriorly also. OLIF only helps in reducing the extent of your fixation, because once you're corrected, you don't have to do a long segment from S1 to T10.
Okay. Basically, you know, this controversy is not a new thing. And anterior approach was very popular in those days also. Even during Dr. Shetty Rangachari, I remember when he visited India, we presented first a thoracolumbar anterior approach, and he was surprised. But then coming down to the abdomen, that L4, L5, L3, you are very comfortable at L3, L4. The moment you see L2, you have a crest coming down, and L1. The moment you come down a little bit, L4, L5 down, then you are scared of the major vessels coming very close. So at L3, L4, we always used to be very comfortable through anterior extrapatinal approach. Now with the development of the newer techniques, which is also going to present later on, it's more easier to do the OLIF. And XLIF a little bit, it always has a little limitation because of the bulk of the muscle, iliopsoas, and so that part of the lower segment at L4, L5, and it's a little bit of concern. Three-dimensional fixation, that is an anterior and posterior, is the ideal.
Okay, sir.
It is ideal, but now it is accepted that at one level, if you're doing at L4, L5 alone fusion, now it is being accepted by many, many, many surgeons, because you don't need to do again posteriorly. But in Korea, I've seen surgeons are doing very fast these techniques.
For 45 minutes they finish.
Posterior pedicle fixation, 30 minutes, 40 minutes they finish that whole procedure, all four screws and percutaneous. So anterior and posterior together by 2 hours they finish it. I was surprised to see, I saw one of the live operative techniques. They did the anterior and posterior in 2 hours time. Maybe it's a good teamwork. The good teamwork make them so fast. But I do not know when we start beginning to do. I was very surprised to see them doing without O arm. They use only the C arm. So quick, I do not know. I think probably Sudhir can also say something about it. So that point, that your point of asking question, do you need to, is this anterior alone is enough? Anterior alone is enough. Manas, do you know about that L5 S1 ALIF which you showed, where the cages are placed? There are instances where the cage pull out. So they give augmenting screws. The technique is very nice. Same augmenting screw, I mean, same component, it's not there for L4 and L5 because we approach through the lateral aspect. So it's a little bit still controversial whether to add posterior or anterior alone is enough.
Yeah, means what we practice is this L5 S1, we do posterior T-lip and posterior fixation. If it's L2, 3, 3, 4 and 4, 5, we can do oblique fusion, and anterior fusion is good enough. If it's degenerative, means grade 1 or 2, where you have to augment with posterior, but it's above L2 and D12, then one has to do X-lip. Because there the lumbar sacral plexus is not there, you can directly go through the muscles.
Yeah. Your question?
We have done 3 olives, but not a large experience anyway. But my biggest nightmare is like, if at all you have to re-explore a olive by any means, I mean at a follow-up. So what are the better options like to deal with it? Because the cages are big, what the olive cages come, they are kind of, they cannot be pulled out from a back posterior approach. Anterior approach, like we have adhesion. So, what are the options that we would be having? Because I looked at all the papers. I mean, no one has written how they have dealt with those cases.
Yeah, the fact that no one has written that nobody had to re-explore. No? So, but then see that is one. If you have a earlier abdominal surgery, that is also is not recommended. And re-exploration is difficult, but then if you have done retroperitoneal, you can always do a transperitoneal. Take out the annulus anteriorly and remove it. So transperitoneal, that can be done.
It will all fibrose within 6 weeks.
Yeah, through the same approach is difficult.
Immediately you can do. Means
through the.
You cannot do anything about that.
Yeah, I mean, the
complication that is very. Then you have to go posteriorly and reconstruct.
Yeah.
I have a comment to make here. See, we all should understand, cages are actually proxies for a tricortical iliac graft. When in those era, I still remember in 93, 94, when pedicle screws were not freely available, there are times when we used to go down behind, put a nice tricortical strut from the back, put the patient on bed and used to do well. The problem what happened is, the graft has a lot of forgiving nature. Even if it extrudes, body takes it away. But that doesn't happen with the cage. So whenever we put a cage, we are forced to instrument the spine. That is the main problem which we have to understand. Suppose in your case, when you don't want to revise an ALIF, instead of putting a cage, you put a tricortical graft. You'll never have to revise it. No, but the posterior or whatever, the bone graft is also a fear. You understand? Because we have done bone grafting ever since we are, into the orthopedic domain. So we are absolutely cool with it. It's probably because there is a long list for you to complete and you don't want to waste another half an hour in bone grafting, you're looking at it. But I think bone grafting actually is the gold standard.
Yep.
Yeah, but means how many times you have explored tea leaf posterior? I'm asking how many, means unlike cervical fixations where you have to re-explore, how many times even if you've done posterior, you have re-explored?
But the thing is, I mean, that would definitely come someday. I mean, if not now, immediately. So no, I'm just kind of want to be imagining, like, I mean, getting stuck on the day may not be an option.
Yeah, the fact that tea leaf and olive has been there for so many years, and
yeah, so many, yeah, correct.
And then nobody has described on re-exploration on tea leaf and olive, when olive is supposed to be a better technique. So I think we'll not, like, people have done 800 cases also, they have not explored.
No, but they would have done some other
procedure. The re-exploration.
They wouldn't have done a re-exploration of olive, but they would have put some bone graft and done a multiple level segmentation.
The re-exploration fear and the re-exploration problems have put lumbar disc arthroplasty in disrepute.
Yeah. That's why it became a big failure. It actually did run out of the literature, not only out of the theater. The interbody.
No, that is in arthroplasty, but not in
arthroplasty.
Fusion, no?
Arthroplasty.
Yeah.
I'm talking about the arthroplasty because I used to enjoy the orthopedic surgeon's terminology, walking disc. They want to walk out. I mean, the moving disc becomes a walking disc.
Okay.
In the lumbar region. Thank you, Manas. Is there any other thing? Yeah. I think so. We call now.